Hello there, my fellow masochistic and narcissistic Dark Elven spin-offs, and welcome back to another episode of the Dark Eldar Race from Warhammer 40k. After two episodes on the flamboyant and exotic witch cults of Qomorrah, and the peculiarities of each of those mini-factions, I wanted to present to you something a bit different. Different, but equally grimdark, with just a shade of BDSM and OP supernatural abilities that you might expect from the Dark Eldar. Thus, today we're gonna talk about the Mandrakes, ladies and gentlemen. Mysterious warriors slash creatures, which don't have a lot of background, but they are associated with the Dark Eldar. So, I am your host, the Archon GDN for today, and without further ado, let us proceed, shall we? A mandrake is a foul humanoid creature that once upon a time was one of the Dark Eldar of Qomorrah, and they are now lurking in the darkest corners of the Webway's labyrinthine confines. The mandrakes can be found in a place called Elendrak, which is a region of Qomorrah. It literally means fallen into shadow, and it is one of the several districts of Qomorrah existing in more than one dimension at any given time. In Elendrak, shadows thicken and writhe as living creatures, flowing into each other and attempting to capture those that venture into the district. It is in Elendrak that mandrakes and another creature called Shade Ravens make their lair. Rumor has it that somewhere in Elendrak, there's an actual portal to a world where Shade Demons exist, who can freeze your soul in a single touch. Shade Ravens are another avian species inhabiting the Elendrak district, and it is said that their croaking can drive one insane. They can be found often among the deadly creatures in the court of an Archon. The vile breed of the Mandrakes is a species feared even by the other Dark Eldar, for a Mandrake is said to be able to pull itself into any region of space-time through another living creature's shadow, emerging with a sibilant hiss to sink its frigid claws and teeth into flesh. Their ebony skins writhe with blasphemous runes, and their faces shift and flow, one moment a featureless mask, the next parting to reveal a maw filled by sharpened teeth. Mandrakes exist both in real space and a cursed dimension that may or may not be part of the Immaterium. To fight them is to combat the living shadow itself. The real origins of the mandrakes remain shrouded in time and secrecy. Some Eldar savants claim that the mandrakes are descended from those of their race inhabiting the Webway, who, before the fall of the Eldar Empire, engaged in heinous acts of lust with demonic entities of the Immaterium. This was all the way back when the, air tags, enlightened Eldar Empire was at its most decadent. Others say that the living shadows are descended from a forbidden Eldar pleasure cult, which found its own way to escape the devastation of the Fall, fleeing into a nightmare dimension of shadow within the Empyrean and re-emerging as something not quite natural anymore. The younger Dark Eldar nicknamed the Mandrakes Creepers, and they whisper that they crawl from one shadow to another and can emerge from one's reflection into the real universe. They believe that the mandrakes are the absence of light given life, and in that aspect they may very well be right. Such theories do not seem so far-fetched when one examines the body of a mandrake. Their flesh is night black, and seems to absorb rather than reflect light. Their featureless faces shift like rancid oil, while their hair is the color of splintered bone. Surrounding them is an aura of darkness and cold that saps the power of all those unfortunate enough to be nearby. Often, the first sign of an imminent mandrake attack will be the onset of a freezing temperature, flash freezing all the moisture out of the very air. The shapes in their flesh are Eldar sigils of destruction, which pulse with a venomous green brilliance when a mandrake feeds upon the terror and pain of a victim. They possess the ability to channel the stolen life energies, shaping blasts of blue-white cold fire known as Bale Blasts, which emerges from their taloned hands to freeze their enemies in place. When they finally fall upon their terrified prey, they don't only use their natural weapons of fang and claw, but also hideous sickle-shaped weapons, actually similar to the surgical tools beloved by the Haemonculi. Like all the inhabitants of the dark city of Komora, the mandrakes thrive on the infliction of pain and terror on other living creatures. It is here that we learn that despite their reputation as monsters of the shadow, they are still rational creatures to some degree, able to communicate or make a deal. As a result of their unsurpassed ability and stealth, many Dark Eldar Archons have sought to hire the Mandrake services for a real space raid by their cabals. The Mandrakes usually ask for a share of the slaves taken as their payment, but sometimes, for reasons unknown, they will ask for something far more unusual, such as a heartbeat, a name, or a voice. Such requests are rarely denied, for the Mandrake's only clothing is a patchwork garment made from the flayed skins of those that had betrayed them. Even an Archon of a Cabal, with all their warriors and retinues, will think twice before messing with a Mandrake. They are infamous for their ability to track down any quarry, and they are able to manifest anywhere in the universe where shadows gather. Sometimes, a Mandrake of particular age and power will join a Dark Eldar raid and lead others of its kind in the taking of slaves or in the pursuit of one of their more esoteric desires. These hideous creatures are known as Night Fiends among the Dark Eldar, and they may possess many powers of the shadow that remain secret even to the denizens of Komora and their masters. One of the most infamous mandrakes ever is known as Keradruak. Keradruak, also lovingly known as the Decapitator, is a long-lost monarch of the mandrakes whose name literally translates into He Who Hunts Heads. He is a dark legend and the patron saint of murder even in the eyes of the other mandrakes, and he rules the shadow realm of Elendrak, which is now spilling over into Komora. This guy has been alive since the time of the Horus Heresy at the very least, and he might have once been one of the ancient Eldar before becoming a Mandrake, believed by some to be the first and greatest among their number. He made a lair in the slowly expanding realm of Elendrak in Komora, and considers all the creatures from the other realms as prey to be hunted or be amused by. For more than 8 millennia, Keradruak killed seemingly at random, sometimes joining a real space raid unexpectedly, or working as an assassin for a ridiculous price in souls. He would hunt his prey for decades at a time sometimes, across a dozen worlds if necessary, lying in wait for weeks or months at a time and await the perfect moment to strike. He took the heads to his lair where he stripped them down to the bone, smashing those that did not meet the requirements, but adding the few that did to one of the thousand niches in the hemispherical walls of his chambers. Each of the skulls, still containing an echo of the soul, stared at the same point above the central dais. During the long midnight in 891 M41, he claimed an unprecedented 7 worthy skulls in only 6 cycles. When the resurrection of El Uriak, the tyrant of Shaddam, triggered a disjunction, threatening to open a hole in reality in Keradruak's lair before the collection was complete, he was disgusted by the part played by the Mandrake brother kings Azoruak and Zakoruak. He had no interest whatsoever in their rivalry, judging their thinking as tainted by the goals of outsiders, and as an affront to the nature of Elendrak. He then killed Azoruak as he fled in defeat from his brother, before returning for Zakoruak as well. The good news is that both their heads were judged worthy, finding places directly opposite each other in Keradruak's lair. With the conspiracy finally over, the fabric between realities was stabilized, although Keradruak believed he sensed a stirring on the other side. After the partial awakening of Ined, created another massive disjunction that caused Komora to fall into chaos, Keradruak killed Archon Sifrak, claiming his head as the final skull required by his collection. For a dozen miles around the Decapitator's throne, Komora became a sea of living shadow consuming even demons. Like all the other mandrakes, Keradruak has chameleonic shadow skin, which, combined with his exceptional skills of stealth, makes him virtually invisible, and allows him to slip out of the slightest shadow to ambush his prey. There are no eyes in his hollow sockets, but he does possess an additional set of taloned arms, possibly the upgrade work of a homunculus. Karadruak's unnatural senses also allow him to interact with the shadow skein of Elendrak itself, detecting the deepest fears and desires of anyone who wanders inside. The weapon of choice of Karadruak is a blade that bears his same name. It is said that no kind of shield can protect you from it, even as it takes the form of a simple, sharp sword of dark metal. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about the mysterious yet horrifying mandrakes of the Dark Eldar for today. Definitely, at least in my opinion, among the most interesting characters / entities related to the Dark Eldar, and why not the Eldar in general. It is usually my belief that if you leave a little mystery to something, you can always make it more compelling. Are you a fan of the mandrakes? What do you like or dislike most about them? Share any thoughts or questions you might have on them in the comments below if you want. Was the episode informative or entertaining? In that case, please click the like button and subscribe for future content. Thanks a lot for watching, and I wish you all an awesome day. The Emperor protects.